today, Russia's President Vladimir Putin gave his annual end-of-year press conference with tough words for both Ukraine and NATO. It comes as Russia has massed tens of thousands of troops on the border with Ukraine. Special correspondent Stuart Smith in Moscow begins our coverage.
In a marathon four-hour press conference today in Moscow, President Putin blamed the West for threatening Russia.
Not one inch to the east is what we were told in the 1990s. And what happened? We were duped. We were brazenly duped. There were five waves of NATO expansion.
After the fall of the Berlin Wall, Russia says the U.S. made a deal that NATO's troops and weapons would not expand further into Eastern Europe. Putin says now Russia is defending itself from increasing NATO encroachment.
And now these missile systems are appearing in Poland and Romania. That's what we're talking about. You have to understand, it's not us who are threatening. And now you're telling us Ukraine will also be in NATO.
This week, NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg said the alliance supports Ukraine's sovereignty and, quote, right to choose its own path. Today, Putin told a room full of journalists that Ukraine will never join NATO.
We put it straight. There must be no further expansion of NATO eastward. What is there not to understand? Was it us who deployed missiles near the borders of the United States? No.
Putin's remarks come a week after Russia submitted a list of security guarantees it wants the West to agree to in order to withdraw its forces near the Ukrainian border. The demands include a ban on a Ukraine-NATO membership, the removal of NATO forces and weapons from much of Eastern Europe, and a promise to not hold further drills in the region without Russian approval. Russia's demands would involve a major reconfiguration of European security, and Vladimir Putin insists on haste or else an unspecified military response. That leaves open questions about whether the calls for negotiation and diplomacy are genuine or designed to fail to justify escalation. For weeks, Russian military drills and irregular deployments signal they're ready for escalation. Satellite images show a massive buildup along the Russian-Ukraine border, and US intelligence produced a map that shows five newly deployed Russian battalion tactical groups north of Ukraine, two newly deployed groups off Ukraine's northeast border, more troops off Ukraine's southeast, where Russia has invaded in the past, and additional tanks and artillery in Russian-annexed Crimea for a potential of tens of thousands of Russian forces.
Good to see you again.
Earlier this month, President Biden told Putin in a video call that Russia faced significant sanctions if it were to invade Ukraine. Biden told Putin the US would increase military support to Ukraine. And the administration said President Biden told Putin that NATO's eastern allies would receive more US troops and training similar to those 2016 exercises. This week, Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky joined Lithuania and Poland to call for stronger Western sanctions against Moscow.
Our common task is to deter the threat posed by Russia and defend Europe from Russia's aggressive policies.
The US says the best way to resolve the conflict is to restore Ukraine's border and to return to the Minsk process, agreements that Russia and Ukraine sought to end the war in Ukraine's eastern Donbass region that began in 2014 between Kyiv and Russian-backed separatists. Putin today said he looked forward to meeting the US in January. The Biden administration says it's willing to meet with Russia in early January, but the details of the meeting have yet to be worked out. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Stuart Smith in Moscow.
And for more on all this, we get two views. Charles Kupchan is a professor at Georgetown University and senior fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations. During the Obama administration, he served as senior director for European affairs on the National Security Council staff. In that job, he traveled to Ukraine six times with then Vice President Biden. And Alina Polyakova is the president of the Center for European Policy Analysis. It's a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization that seeks to promote U.S.-European relations and democratic values. And we welcome both of you to the NewsHour. Charles Kupchan, to you first. Is Vladimir Putin correct when he says the West and NATO have reneged on the promises they made in the 1990s not to move closer to the east? He said, in fact, there have been five waves of NATO expansion.
Well, exactly what was agreed to in the early days of the end of the Cold War remains an issue of great dispute among historians. What is clear is that what we're seeing today is the culmination of a big dispute that started in the early 1990s during the Clinton administration, when there was a debate about whether NATO should expand eastward toward Russia's borders. In the spirit of full disclosure, I was working in the National Security Council then and was somewhat skeptical of the enlargement of NATO because of the concern that Putin is now expressing about the alliance moving closer to Russia's borders. We then did proceed. President Putin is right. We've been through a succession of waves. And in 2008, NATO declared that Georgia and Ukraine would one day be in line for membership. I think there are a lot of troubling aspects of Russian behavior, a lot of things to worry about, but Putin is not out of the ordinary in being concerned about NATO expansion into Ukraine. It's kind of what major powers do. The United States spent a lot of time in the 19th century getting Britain and France and Spain and Russia out of its neighborhood. The Soviets deployed missiles to Cuba in 1962. We didn't like that very much. There was almost a war over that. So major powers don't like it when other major powers bring in military force to their borders. That's kind of what we're seeing to come to a head today.
So, Alina Polyakova, I mean, just picking up on that and these points that Charles Kupchan is making, is there justification in the argument that Vladimir Putin is making that the West has moved too far in his direction, in Russia's direction, and steps need to be taken to correct that?
Well, thank you so much for that question, Judy. And Charlie is completely right in outlining the most recent post-Cold War history. But I think what we have to remember is that point number one, that in 2008, during the summit where NATO said that eventually Ukraine and also Georgia could join NATO, NATO membership is really not on the table at all today for Ukraine or Georgia. We have to be clear about that. So when Mr. Putin says that NATO is looking to expand into Ukraine, that is just completely false. There's no indication that Ukraine will be joining NATO anywhere in the short or medium term. The second point I think to make here is that it's Russia that has been the aggressor here. Much of NATO's posture in its eastern flank in Poland as well as Romania changed because Russia invaded and continues to occupy Crimea, and it continues to occupy parts of Ukraine's Donbas. So it was really Russia that has sort of forced this kind of response and forced more security posture from NATO in its eastern flank. But Ukraine is not a NATO member state, nor is there a clear plan for Ukraine to become a member state anytime soon.
So given this, Charles Kupchan, and you've been an advocate for diplomatic efforts here. I mean, do you see the potential for successful diplomacy in all this? And by the way, do you think Vladimir Putin has made up his mind yet about whether to invade Ukraine?
I don't think that he has made up his mind. And that's in part because he is going through the motions of trying to have a serious conversation with NATO, with the United States. It's also the case that this would not be an easy war. This would be a big war. Lots of fatalities on the Russian as well as the Ukrainian side. And Putin is pretty good about picking his fights carefully. I'm not sure this is a fight that he wants. I completely agree with Alina that right now, NATO enlargement to Ukraine is not on the table. The President of the United States has said as much. The U.S. and its allies have been careful about not putting high-end, high-technology weaponry into Ukraine because they are sensitive about Russia's concerns. Russia is the aggressor here. They went into Crimea. They took Donbas. It seems to me that if there is to be a meeting of the minds, it's that NATO stands by its principle, open door, countries can choose their future, but they can reassure Putin that for now and for the foreseeable future, NATO enlargement is not in the cards for Ukraine, nor is Ukraine going to turn into an outpost of NATO force posture.
Alina Polyakova, do you see the realistic prospects that this can be worked out through some sort of diplomatic arrangement, agreement?
Well, I certainly hope so. We're facing a potentially devastating situation. A military invasion, a full-out military war in Europe hasn't happened since really World War II, and the consequences would be absolutely dire, not just for Russia and Ukraine, but for all of Europe, and as a result, for the Transatlantic Alliance and NATO, of which the United States, of course, is a member. So we have to remember what's really at stake here. And that's why diplomacy really has to be on the table. I think the United States government has deployed a huge amount of diplomatic resources to try to bring Russia back to the table here. We've had calls from the U.S. president. We've had visits from the chief of the CIA. At all levels of government, there's been a concerted effort to bring Russia into dialogue. Unfortunately, what we've seen from Moscow over the last several weeks is some clear and worrisome signals that they're not actually interested in a real diplomatic dialogue. One data point on that is these NATO-Russia-US treaties, so-called treaties that Moscow decided to publish very publicly before they were even discussed with the United States and NATO. This was a very, very unusual step when it comes to diplomatic relations, and it was taken as pretext for Russia looking for complete no from the United States and NATO, and this would be a pretext for a potential invasion. That's why the situation is quite dire and quite serious.
And just in a few seconds, Charles Kupchin, you agree the signals don't look receptive from Moscow?
Well, the proposals that Putin put out over the last week are non-starters, many of them. The good news is a conversation will take place. The United States and Russia look like they're going to be meeting, sitting down at the table in early January. I think this is the best way to avoid a war that would be neither in the interests of neither Ukraine nor Russia nor NATO. Let's hope that diplomacy prevails.
Charles Kupchin, Alina Polyakova, we thank you both.